a man convicted of murder wrongfully has his conviction overturned because it was discovered that the detective and the witness were having an affair. Let's put up the picture for mass here. Talk about insanity. Lamont Cambell, a St. Louis man, was convicted of murder in 2016. He's now a free man after prosecutors dropped all charges. Cambell walked out of the St. Louis City Justice Center on the 19th of this month. St. Louis Circuit Judge Timothy Boyer overturned the conviction back in December after ruling that Mr. Cambell had ineffective representation. The judge also ruled that the prosecutors failed to disclose that the case's lead investigator had been having an affair with one of the witnesses who identified Mr. Cambell. You have a double whammy already. The first whammy, well, he has ineffective counsel. And believe me, it takes a lot for a judge to make that ruling. The judge says, your counsel was so bad, I'm not going to tell you to file a bar complaint. I'm going to correct it myself. That is rare because you do have an administrative remedy through the bar. Judge said, no, this was too egregious for that. And coupled with the fact that it seemed as if the prosecution decided to ignore material facts that were connected to the case. There's more. Cambell was found guilty of the 2011 death of the 29-year-old Lenny J. Gregory III. Mr. Gregory was found shot to death while sitting in his car on the 2800 block of Sheraton Street in South St. Louis. Cambell was just 17 years of age at the time, claimed his innocence then, and maintained his innocence every single day. After jurors failed to come to a unanimous verdict the first time, this was the trial in 2013, prosecutors retried the man in 2016. Cambell was then convicted at his second trial and sentenced to life in prison with parole eligibility after 30 years. Three witnesses, two of whom are husband and wife, claimed that Cambell was the shooter and that he had attempted to rob Mr. Gregory, the son of a retired cop. Mr. Gregory was shot in the arm and in the head. However, the murder weapon, which was a 38 caliber, was never found. Now, I'm reminding you, he did this allegedly when he was 17 years of age, okay? That's according to the narrative of the prosecutor at that time. There was also no physical evidence, none, that connected Mr. Cambell. Boyer was prepared to set a new trial date, that's the judge. He said, all right, ineffective counsel, obviously, there's an affair happening with your lead witness. We're gonna go ahead and reset the trial. But instead, the circuit attorney's office dismissed the charges against Mr. Cambell. The prosecutors also announced they would be conducting a new investigation into the death of Mr. Gregory. What happens when a person is wrongfully convicted? Yes, it is an injustice to those who have been wrongfully convicted by this injustice system. It is a double injustice for the family who has to live with the fact that the person who did this to their family member is free. Free. That is also a miscarriage of justice. There's more. The dismissal came as a surprise because the circuit attorney, Marvin Teer, asked the judge to give him until the end of the day to propose a new trial date in April. Teer appeared to leave the courtroom to take a phone call, and when he returned a few moments later, he announced that the charges against Mr. Cambell have been dismissed that would have come from his higher up, despite Cambell's conviction being overturned. The victim's family was not happy that he was released and reportedly got into a heated discussion with the prosecutor about the case. The prosecutor said he simply is not convinced that Cambell is guilty and reportedly said to Gregory's family, "I'm not convinced he did it. And as far as I'm concerned, one day in jail is too many if he didn't do it." Tier told the family, Cambell told reporters outside the courtroom, and let's put his picture back up again. He told the family outside of the courtroom, "I'm just happy to be out." This saga began at 17 for him. 17 years of age, railroaded by the justice system, not represented properly by his own counsel, a person who went to school, passed the bar, and took an oath to represent to his fullest capacity. Failed. He then has a prosecutor whose job is not to seek prosecutions, but literally a prosecutor swears an oath to do one thing, to uphold justice. That's what's on the oath for prosecutors. Once again, they failed him too. And that initial judge who oversaw their case, saw the misrepresentation, failed him as well. The police officer, the detective in charge of the case, having a sexual affair with the lead witness, not exposing this material information, another failure in the justice system. All of that and the lack of any physical evidence whatsoever still landed a black male in prison for a murder he did not commit. No evidence, no material evidence. The eyewitness was compromised, and you had ineffective counsel and a prosecutor who was willing to break the law. All right. Ben, thoughts on this?
Yeah, I mean, this is a really unfortunate story. It's like really heartbreaking to see somebody's life like really taken from them for however many years just because of our legal system. Because the unfortunate reality is he's the exception more than the rule. This happens all the time in the United States of America. And now he maintained his innocence, but a lot of people get bullied and pressured into taking like plea bargains, even though they're innocent. Like literally like prosecutors and police officers will use very harsh interrogation methods. Sometimes they'll threaten to investigate family members. You know, they will do a lot of things that are very much illegal in other countries in order to coerce confessions and stuff. But then it goes to the question of eyewitness testimony. Why are we trusting eyewitness testimony? There's tons and tons of evidence that eyewitness testimony, especially when you're talking about like a black man being on trial in the United States of America, you need a lot more than eyewitness testimony to like actually prove something, because we know how steeped in racism our society fundamentally is. And there's like this, so there's really like so many layers to this. But the unfortunate reality is that this is kind of how our justice system is built to be like, because the real thing is there should be an independent, completely separate agency that's responsible for storing all evidence that prosecutors and police officers collect. Fundamentally, even the idea that prosecutors and police officers are the ones that have material control over evidence is completely absurd, because we know the bias that prosecutors have. We know that prosecutors are going to want to put somebody in jail regardless as to whether or not they're innocent. And this has been proven time and again. And then when it comes to public defenders, not only is access to public defenders means tested, which means you don't really have a right to public defense, but also public defenders are like greatly underfunded. And so while like detectives, police officers, and prosecutors will all work together with massive budgets, right, to use like all this advanced technology and sometimes even just pseudoscience like lie detector tests and other things like that against, you know, defendants. Defendants have typically, like if they have like a public defender, we'll have a public defender who has maybe 4 hours to spend on their case if they're lucky, and they have 30 other cases that they're working with. And so our entire system is really just rigged against marginalized people. It's rigged against anybody that can't afford a team of investigators of their own and their own like private lawyer. Like, and so like this is really, really heartbreaking. But I think what makes this even more heartbreaking is that he got out. He actually got like in the end some semblance of justice, where he was finally able to have his freedom, when unfortunately across the United States of America, there are tons of innocent people who are currently in prison because they got railroaded by the system just like this.
There's a law professor named John Rappin. He has a book called Gideon's Promise. And this book highlights what you just talked about, the reality of public defenders in America, how they are underfunded, how they are not part of the criminal justice reform conversation, typically because they're not invited into it. And it's not truly an adversarial system because the resources are not equitable. And I agree with them. Another dynamic, there are many, many good public defenders. Their hearts are in the right place. But there are also some public defenders who are simply prosecutors light. And they work in a way that's not as heavy as the prosecutor, but very similar. It is supposed to be adversarial system to be effective.